Good day, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the UFO Movies India Limited Q2 and H1 FY22 earnings conference call. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal the operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Vikram Ramalingam. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thanks, Lizan. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for joining us today. Maybank Kim Eng is pleased to host the conference call for UFO Movies to discuss the second quarter and first half of FY22 ended in September 2021. From the management side, we have Mr. Kapil Agarwal, the Joint Managing Director of the company, and Mr. Ashish Malushre, the CFO of the company. Over to you, Kapilji, to present your opening remarks, after which we'll have the Q&A session. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much, Vikram, and greetings, everyone, and thank you all for joining our 2022 Q2 and first half earnings call. Before I start, I do hope that all of you had a great Diwali holiday and got the opportunity to, in our selfish interest, visit cinemas. That's what I'm saying, because now the cinemas are open. Okay, let me start with the highlights of this quarter. With a steady decline in the COVID cases and progress made on the vaccination front, the state governments started permitting cinemas to reopen from around mid-July, one by one, but with restrictions on the seating capacity, other protocols, other restrictions, et cetera. However, Maharashtra, which is the major market for Hindi movie, which actually contributes to around 25%-30% of the all India revenue for any Hindi movie, and without which Hindi movie generally don't release, this continued to remain closed. As a result, no big budget Hindi movie released until started releasing, you know, from July till October, except one or two movie here and there, like Bell Bottom released in the meantime without Maharashtra. But since the Hindi movies did not release, the regional movies started getting fair share of, you know, their revenues. In North India, you know, Gujarati movies, Punjabi movies, Bengali movies in non-South states, I mean, all these movies, they did good business. Some revenue started for us. It also contributed to the growth of these regional cinemas. The other major market which continued to remain closed was Kerala, which was seeing a huge, you know, incidence of the COVID cases. In the Hindi movie circuits, the theaters started opening once the government of Maharashtra declared the theaters to be reopened from October 2022. At the same time, Kerala government also allowed the theaters to open from 25th October. Now, you know, in last three weeks, the situation has changed dramatically. As we speak, majority of the cinemas across the country have opened. There are few cinemas which are yet to open, which are in the process of opening, you know, because after remaining shut for almost one year, one and a half years, I mean, there are a lot of local issues like permissions, upkeep, because nobody knew actually when the cinemas will be allowed to open. But by and large, a lot of cinemas have, majority of the cinemas have opened. Slowly and gradually, the restriction on the seating capacity are also being lifted. A number of states like Telangana, Andhra Pradesh, Rajasthan, Karnataka, Gujarat, Delhi, UP, Tamil Nadu, Odisha, Punjab, they've all allowed 100% seating capacity, but few continue with 50 to 70% capacity. The opening of the theaters in Maharashtra was welcomed with the announcement of release of big budget movies. So first of all, you know, Reliance Entertainment, which was sitting on the blockbuster called Suryavanshi, which was supposed to release exactly 1 or 2 days before the country went to lockdown in March 2020. I think it scheduled for 24th of March last year and waited for more than 1.5 years to release. So, and they had another movie called 83. So they picked up the date of Diwali and Christmas. The moment they picked up, Yashraj Studio was sitting with the slate of 4 movies. So they immediately declared, and then there was a race in the amongst the producers, because they found that all the big dates are going. And you know, now till for next 6 months, actually, if I may say so, practically every weekend is blocked with a major movie. And so post opening of Maharashtra, you know, Suryavanshi released on 5th of November. Anate, which is a Rajinikanth starrer blockbuster, you know, and which was released by us on an All India basis by UFO, except for the southern states, that released on the a day before, on the 4th of November. And despite all the capacity constraints, the first weekend itself saw a 100 crore business for both the movies on a global basis. And just on an All India basis also, by Monday, Tuesday, they did, first 5 days, they did over 100 crores. So that showed the pent-up demand, the eagerness of the audiences to come back to the theater to vengeance, and probably that also shows what is for us in store in future. And now, as I said, the movie pipeline for next 6 months, practically every weekend is blocked, and very, very good movies like 83, which I mentioned, Gangubai Kathiawadi, Satyamev Jayate, Shamshera, Prithviraj, Lal Singh Chadda, Triple R, all these are blockbuster movies. Rocketry. So these are all releasing, and we are involved in releasing some of these movies also in some circuits. So, looking at this movie slate, we believe that it is going to be really exciting time for all stakeholders of the film exhibition industry. And the theatrical business may actually revive much faster than what most people thought of or predicted. That's becoming very clear to us. I touched upon the film distribution side, so you would recall that last time, in the last call, I had mentioned that we released 11 movies before the second lockdown happened. So after getting into the business in December last year, till March, we had released 11 movies. And after the cinemas reopened, we have released another 7 movies, Anate being the latest movie. And actually today we have released a Malayalam movie called Kuro, which is Dulquer Salman movie, and that we have released again on an All India basis, except in southern states, in 3 languages, which is Malayalam, Tamil and Hindi, right, is what we have released. So we have also started witnessing an uptick in the BPF revenues, digitization income, and I think advertisers have been cautious, so we expect that slowly and steadily the advertisers will also come back on the medium. We have already started seeing some advertising revenue from this week, from last week, I mean, when Suryavanshi released. Coming to the headline numbers, which you all must have seen for the quarter ended, the consolidated revenue stood at 265 million rupees for Q2 as compared to 140 million rupees in Q2 of FY21. But FY21 was a complete lockdown, and majority of the revenues were only and only from the sale of equipment, that also in our international market like Middle East. EBITDA loss for Q2 22 was 152 million compared to the EBITDA loss of 218 million in Q2 21. Loss at PAT level was 283 million as compared to loss of 307 million in Q2 of 21. During H1 22, the consolidated revenue stood at 546 million as compared with 306 million in H1 21. EBITDA loss reduced to 333 million compared to 450 million in H1 of 21. Loss at PAT level stood at 550 million compared with 639 million last year, H1. As far as consolidated funds position is concerned, balance at the end of the quarter stood at 610 million compared with 1,284 million in Q2 of 21. On the debt front, as on September 30, 2021, the net debt of the company stood at 425 million rupees compared with net cash of 87 million in Q2 of 21. Also, you all must be aware that the board of directors of the company at its meeting held on November 3, 2021 has approved a fundraising of fresh equity through preferential allotment aggregating 96.82 crores, of course subject to necessary approvals. We have already sent notice for the EGM, which is scheduled for the 26th of November. These funds will not only provide us with the requisite financial flexibility but also help in accelerating our strategic priorities. All relevant information and communications are of course available on our website as well as with the exchanges. Lastly, I would like to take this opportunity to thank all our stakeholders for their continued trust in the company during these unprecedented times. We are fairly optimistic that as the situation improves further, the film industry will recover at a rapid pace and our business and financial performance will be restored soon. With that, I would like to open the floor with your questions.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin with the question and answer session. Anyone wishing to ask a question may please press star and one on your touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Participants, if you wish to ask a question, you may please press star and one. A reminder to the participants, anyone wishing to ask a question may please press star and one. The first question is from the line of Vikram Ramalingam. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity, sir. My question is regarding the financial muscle of, so basically the top two multiplex players and as well as you, by virtue of being listed, were able to raise capital and obviously increase your muscle power. But what about the non-listed and especially most of the single screens or small multiplex chains? There are some reports that we keep reading that 10% or 5% have permanently shut down due to remaining shut for the last 1.5-2 years. So any guidance on that?
Yeah, so you see, while the multiplexes who are listed were able to raise funding, obviously the unlisted sector got affected But at the same time, please note that all these unlisted or small chains or the sector, they are all privately owned. Their overhead levels are much, much lower. The single screens all over the country, you know, they have their own property, unlike the multiplexes who have to take very expensive properties on rental in the malls. They have their own family-owned properties. They manage the theaters themselves, unlike the huge amount of people which are required by multiplexes. So obviously, multiplexes overhead level and maintenance level is very, very high, and the interest costs are very high, which is not the case with the smaller chains and the single screens all over the country. Having said that, I think your estimate is very right. According to us, overall 5 to 6% screens will be shutting down permanently. So to that extent, the screen universe will get reduced. Although we are also seeing that a lot of people who have single screens, they use this period to actually demolish the properties and converted them into two or three screen properties. So some of these screens are also coming back much improved. But yes, as per our estimate, based on the information available with us, 5 to 6% screens should shut down.
My second and last question is regarding the advertising income. In case of most big TV channels, basically the TV ads are back. The volumes in case of television is back, and some are saying that it is back to pre-pandemic levels. Over here, with respect to cinemas in general, so what is that trigger point, do you think? Is it allowing full occupancy, or is it after, let's say, two or three big ticket movies getting released and their box office collection, basically blockbuster hits, and then you expect them to go back to normalcy, the ad volumes?
So TV was always there during the pandemic. So TV revenue kept going up and down, but you know, they never disappeared. While in the case of cinema, the revenues completely disappeared. So we have been engaged now since the cinema started reopening. Obviously, nobody was willing to advertise. So we started seeing some advertisement in the south, southern states, because south movies were releasing, Tamil, Telugu movies were releasing in last 2-3 months. And Hindi market, as I said, because of Maharashtra not opening up, no major movie was releasing. But with Suryavanshi, almost entire market, all states, they have opened up. And you'll be surprised that the weekend collection of Suryavanshi and of Anate, which is Rajinikanth's movie, like Anate's collection with even limited capacity in many states, was higher than Rajinikanth's last movie, which was Darbar. So suddenly the cinema we are seeing has come back with the vengeance. Similarly, the collection of Suryavanshi has been much higher than the last movie of Salman, of Akshay Kumar, which released pre-pandemic. So suddenly, despite the capacity constraints, a lot of people coming back. Now coming back to your question of advertising. So we have engaged with them. So one, some advertising has already started flowing in the Hindi market as well, which is a major contributor to the advertising scene. The advertisers, when we engaged with them, they were cautiously optimistic, I would say. So while they started putting some small monies, but they said we will wait for the audiences to come back. We are not sure whether, you know, there is a fear in the minds of people, because there was so much of uncertainty during these 18 months, whether a third lockdown will happen, third wave will come, whether people are going to come back. So I think a lot of those questions have been answered. So they are not really looking for the capacities to be restored. They are looking at the footfalls, and the footfalls are happening. So the average footfalls, I would say, are reaching at the same level despite capacity constraints in many states. With constrained capacity, they are comparable with what footfalls were happening in percentage utilization in terms of the theaters pre-pandemic. So we are already reaching there, because now all seats are full, and people are coming back with vengeance. So I think it's a matter of couple of weeks. People are watching. So we have started obviously increasing our engagement with the theater with the advertisers, and it should start seeing uptick. But it will take time. It's not going to go to the pre-pandemic level very rapidly. Secondly, the government also has so far not started spending. Now we are warming up the central government, DAVP, etc. also, because our revenue, half revenue comes from corporate sector, half other half comes from the government. So I think, and now the elections coming, and government should also start increasing the spends in months to come. So I think next couple of months we should see significant improvement.
All right, that's it from my side.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, anyone wishing to ask a question, may please press star and one. The next question is on the line of Devarsh Vakil from HSL. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Sir, I have a couple of questions. Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, Devarsh.
Thank you. So, I have a couple of questions. The first being the money which we have raised, 96.82 crore, for you just mentioned that we are going to use it for the, I think, strategic something. So, can you please give some more color on how you are going to spend this money? Is it going to use to repay some of the debt which you have taken, and what kind of capacity you are going to do out of it?
I think there was a very loud sound behind you, Devarsh. I'll address your question.
Am I audible now, sir? Sorry.
No, you were very clearly audible, but there was somebody else talking very loudly behind you. That was the problem.
Sorry, sir. Yeah. Okay, now I think it should be better. I've just been...
Yeah, absolutely no problem.
So 96.82 crore which we have raised in...
I understood you. I heard your question. You are clear. As you know that during the entire pandemic, 18 or 19 months, we survived with our own cash and we did not raise any fresh funding from the equity. And full 19 months, we did not fire any employees. We passed this entire period without any funding. So right now, the whole objective of raising this funding is one, we just wanted to have sufficient cash in the bank in case any third wave happens. That is point number one. Point number two, when I say strategic initiatives, I mean it can be anything, because right now there may be many organic, inorganic opportunities available. We have not decided upon anything. It is just money in the bank. Like we had substantial cash in the bank and substantial leveraging available when the pandemic hit us in March last year. Because of that sufficiency of cash and the leveraging which was available, we could survive the entire pandemic and we have come out of it. Similarly, now we want to have sufficient cash in our bank. We don't want to be constrained if there are any opportunities come, because we believe that there will be opportunities available in the market. Which we can take advantage of, because everybody may not be having sufficient cash like we have, or we had, or we have now. So it is just replenishing our kitty, cash kitty. There is no concrete proposal on the table. Right now we are busy in reopening, bouncing back, and we will keep our eyes and ears open. Whenever there is any initiatives come up, any opportunities come up, the board will meet and decide from time to time.
Okay, sir. Second question is regarding the businesses. So I just want to understand two things. One, since there was a prolonged lockdown, do we require to spend money to get back to the earlier stage for our exhibition equipment? Will we need to spend money just to get our equipment going again as per the they were earlier? First question. And the second question regarding the distribution business. For example, this Tamil movie which we have released in the Hindi circuit, whatever, so earlier we have decided we are not going to go for the minimum guarantee kind of distribution business. So whatever ticket revenue comes, certain percentage will flow to us. So is there an upside in the distribution business? So what kind of margin do you expect in distribution business? Is it that if a film becomes a super hit, we tend to earn more out of those revenues? Is it possible?
So, first question first, on the maintenance equipment, one, during the pandemic, as I mentioned in my previous question, that we did not fire any employees. So, all our engineers, all our employees, all our regional people, we were maintaining. So, we were also using them, actually, in the preventive maintenance. So, from time to time, because these are all electronics, so they need to be maintained. So, you know, wherever possible, wherever theaters allowed, wherever theaters reopened. And also, you know, after the first lockdown, the theaters did open and they were open for 6 months. So we did not see any substantial, cycle of spending money. And the second lockdown was only for 3-4 months. So we kept the machines well oiled, as I may say, kept maintaining them. So there will be no major capex. This is all going to be maintenance capex. So normal maintenance capex. There is nothing much. I mean, I would say if I was spending 1 crore rupees on maintenance capex, now it becomes 1.2 crore rupees. That 10-20% extra I can't rule out. But there is no major capex or maintenance cost which over which I would lose my sleep. So that's the answer to question number one. Question number two. Our policy of distribution continues to be the same. We do not give any minimum guarantee. We don't invest in the content. We do not acquire any movies. We are doing a purely fee-based distribution business. And because of our network and access to the exhibitors all over the country and our relationship with them, generally, now why we are getting so many movies for distribution, almost one movie a week we are releasing now, or whatever it came, whether it's a small movie, whether it's a big movie, whether we are releasing it all India, whether we are releasing it in certain region, certain film circuit. But it is giving more and more confidence to the producers that UFO is able to provide a far greater access to these screens. The number of screens on which his movie releases is far greater, and his collections are more secure because of the UFO's relationship with all these theaters. And continuously, we have to give them movie week after week. So normally, exhibitors don't bother us with the collection. So it is giving more and more confidence to the producers, and this business is expanding. I think eventually this will become a steady revenue generation business, and we do not intend even in future to invest money in the content by way of MGs or by way of the acquisition of content. That policy remains intact. It's purely fee-based business. That's it.
So the percentage of fee which we get, is there an upside to the success of the film, or it is just a fixed percentage which we get for every film?
These are normally fixed percentages. These are as a percentage of the box office collection. So It's not that if the movie does more than 100 crore, I will get 5% extra commission. It is not like this. It is actually normally fixed commission. There is no upside. It's a pure fee-based business. Idea is that without spending any money on infrastructure and people, because we already had these 24 offices all over India, we already had people who were connected with the producers, because every producer had to come to us to release their movie digitally. We were connected with all the exhibitors because we service them day in and day out. We could give them the equipment, we maintain the equipment, we give them the release order of the movie, license of the movie every week on week. So we are connected on both sides. So it was a very seamless transition, addition of a fee-based business without increase of any expenditure or without taking any risk.
It was not an absolute fixed fee, it is percentage to box office.
Yeah, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. No, it is percentage. No, no, no. Ashish, I can't say that.
In some
because it sometimes, so mostly it is a percentage, X percentage of the box office collection. Sometimes it will be a fixed fee also, because if there is some movie which is very small, and we feel that we will not be making, this movie will not collect even 50 lakh rupees. So our time is worth something. We say, okay, I'll charge you minimum 10 lakh or 20 lakh or 15 lakh rupee fee. So there may be some cases where we charge a fixed fee also, but normally it is a percentage. By and large, it is a percentage of the box office.
Right, sir. So third question is regarding this virtual print crisis. I think because of the pandemic, we gave certain discounts to our customers. Now, is it coming? Are you taking back? The prices are coming back to the normal earlier you were charging for this digitization? And what do you expect we need to get normal rates once? That's the virtual print crisis question I had.
Okay, so virtual print fee, obviously to bring the cinemas, encourage the release of more and more content, we gave certain concessions, which started, we gave concession of as high as 100% of the virtual print fee waiver initially, so that some movies are released. Now, as the movies started coming back to the theaters, we started withdrawing those concessions. For example, when last month the major movie released, we reduced the discount from 100% to 75%. This month, we have reduced it to 50%. Like movies like Suryavanshi and all the YRF movies and other movies which are releasing for November, we have reduced the discount to 50%. So that is number one. That is in the Hindi market. We are also assessing the situation market by market. Like for example, when we saw that Punjabi movies and Gujarati movies, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, also are doing well. So I said, they don't need concession. They are making 20, 30 crore rupees of revenue on a 3 crore budget movie. So why should we not take our share? So there we went and, you know, for example, we reduced the discount to 25%. So already Gujarat, Punjab, states like Gujarat, Punjab are at 25% discount. Hindi market is at 50% discount. Bengali market is at 0 discount. We have already increased the VPF to 100% in Bengali market. Now, since this was the first month, we also had to see the trend. We had to also see the trend, whether, you know, people come back, whether movies are making money. Now there is absolutely no doubt that movies are making money. I mean, if first weekend two big movies are doing 100 crore plus business worldwide, and in India itself, you know, they were at 75, 80, 90 crores just in the first 3 days. There is no reason, and people are coming. There is no reason of continuing these discounts. So, from next month, which is because now we also have a slate of big movies for next 6 months. Almost every week is booked. So we will be reducing the discount to probably zero in next month, or maybe a 10-15%, because Maharashtra, depending on whether Maharashtra state opens, whether other states open which are at 50 or 60%, whether they go to 100% capacity by end of the month. So it's a very, you know, moving target. We take decision based on various business factors. So if the cinemas are allowed to open 100%, if not, maybe we will reduce it to a 25% discount for the month of December. If they reopen, it may be 10% or a 0% maybe. So that call we'll be taking. But as I said, as you can see the trend clearly, Gujarat, Punjab, discount is 25%. Maharashtra, from Hindi market, from 100% discount, we have brought it down to 50%, which will further go down. West Bengal, from a 100% discount, we have brought it up to 100% VPF. And I must say, I must thank all the producer community also. They have also been very, very, very supportive of us, because they realize, they understand our need, like the need of the theater. So, although every producer wanted everything free, but when we explained our situation to them and the need, they all have been very, very supportive. They have helped, they are helping us restoring our VPF.
Right. So my last question is, suppose things remain on track and things if normalize, we have Maharashtra opening, everything, say by March of 2020 everything is back to normal, what kind of we have now different segments. So one is the digitization, another is the distribution segment, we have those trading wolf and trading and other businesses and apps. What kind of revenue potential we have for all these three different segments for next year, assuming everything comes back to normal from March 22?
You see, distribution business, I have a lot of confidence on, because I know the kind of movies that we are negotiating and the kind of bigger, the movies are getting bigger and bigger. So starting from a very, very small movie. And we have also created a niche where we have now started bringing a lot of South Indian movies, South Indian blockbuster movies of Rajinikanth, Surya, Vijay, Dulquer Salman. I mean, all these people are very well known personalities, but their movies were not coming into the north because they did not find any distributor. So we have created, carved out a niche for ourselves. And we are bringing a lot of South Indian movies into North India. And with that, even movies, the size of the movies is getting bigger and bigger. So so I think that business should stabilize very well. So far as the wolf earmark business is concerned, it's a temporary business. You know, it's a COVID related business. Wolf earmark we are selling, you know, as a product to safeguard people from to neutralize the virus. I think as more and more vaccination happens, as more and more safety and security comes, so I don't think that's a sustainable business. That's a business which is a one-time business which is giving us some cash. And with the help of all these initiatives and our existing cash, that is why without raising any capital, we were able to survive 19 months. So as I said, that should be a steady business. Distribution, I can't give a number because, you know, this is a function of third parties. We hope it will be a steady business and we will move into bigger and bigger movies with more and more collections. And Wolf is a I would say a temporary business or a opportunistic business, I would say. As long as it continues, give some cash to support ourselves and grow, use that cash for the growth.
All right, sir. I'll get back to interview you. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is in the line of Rahul Dani from Monarch Networth. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity, sir. So just want to understand about our Zingling app. How are we looking at this and how do you see the OTT platform going forward? Also, my second question is on the caravan business. Are we looking to, re-enter the caravan business, and what is the good opportunity in caravan business for us?
Okay. So far as Zingling is concerned, as I have always maintained, these are the long-term value creation businesses. Businesses like Zingling, they need a lot of capital to grow, to acquire customers, and create value. We obviously, from UFO, the idea was that using our existing people, network, capabilities, people were sitting, why don't we develop something? So Zingling has been fully developed. It is housed in a separate subsidiary. Very limited capital has gone into development of this app. Now it's in a separate subsidiary. If on its own, whenever it is able to raise funding, because there will be independent funding of that project, because we don't intend burning UFO's capital into this app. And this so this is a long-term value creation business. There is no, it's a very dynamic situation. We will continue looking for opportunities for people to come as partners and develop it further. But as I said, it's a long-term value creation business. Nothing in it in the short run. So far as caravan is concerned, it's not a question, Rahul, of getting back into caravan. We were always in caravan business. We are in caravan business and we will be running caravan business. We own these 115 odd vans. But since the whole country was under lockdown, there was no business for caravan. We are reactivating it now, obviously. We are already engaged with various sectors. And I think from next quarter, we will start seeing some revenues coming from Caravan.
Okay. Thank you so much. All the best. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Urmil Shah from Haitong Securities. Please go ahead. Urmil, your line is in the talk mode. Please go ahead. Mr. Urmil Shah, your line is in the talk mode. Please go ahead.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
Yes, sorry for that. Thanks for the opportunity, sir. Firstly, would want to congratulate you for sailing through very well in the tough times. And the augmentation of capital is also a very good sign. So my question was more on the strategic roadmap. If you look at, say, 3 to 5 years down the line, you know, how do you see the business reshaping, you know, with a good opportunity in the distribution side and also the new initiatives?
Hi, Urmil.
Hi, sir.
So, firstly, thank you very much. I mean, yes, it was a tough period, but I think you will agree with me that this speaks volumes about the strength of the financial strength of the company and the way the company has been managed, that without raising any funding, we were able to sail through the entire period without actually firing any of the 1,200-1,300 employees. So, so we were able to manage that. The strategic roadmap, as you know, so I think the one of the major business that I feel should build up over next 2-3 years is as you rightly pointed out, the distribution business, fee-based distribution business, and the reason also is that, you know, there were a lot of corporate distributors in the country. And particularly in the market, and all the corporate distributors, because they made very heavy investment into the content, into the acquisition of content, creation of content, they all lost money because nobody can guarantee whether the content will what content will work and what content will not work. You make money from 20 movies and you lose money, entire money in one movie. So eventually the all these corporate distributors they shut down. There were a lot of corporate distributors. Right now, distribution has become a very unorganized play in the country. And there is no all India corporate distributor which is there. Even the known players in the industry, known individual players or smaller or even the big players, they all, nobody has an all India network like us. And that is where we saw the opportunity. We said, let's get into it. And we learned by the mistake of the other corporate distributor decided not to invest in the content. Remain very, very focused on the fee-based business. I think, and people trust in the integrity of UFO because, you know, the settlements, UFO, money, a lot of corporate distributor people were not getting the account for a few months, 6 months, 1 year, final accounts were not getting. While in our case, we settle every penny very, very quickly. So I think this will bring more and more goodwill. Our existing goodwill, we get more goodwill and more work. So this is one. And second, you know, the long-term initiatives, like we have started an app called Zimlin, which I just addressed. Then there is another app called OTT platform called Plexigo. Then there is also the interest continues to be very live in the exhibition business, which was Nova Cinema. So, because India has a dearth of cinema, there are 70,000 screens in China. India, we were just talking 9,000 screens, another 5% screens will shut down, we'll be at 8,500 screens. 8,500 screens is what, 6 screens per million of population. That, this one. And for a movie loving country. So we have identified the virgin region where there is no screen in 50 kilometer radius. So models are being worked out. how do we accelerate, create, you see, semi-urban and rural India does not have any access to the cinema. All the cinemas are in the urban area, wherever they are. So a lot of work has been going on the exhibition business, which also creates a lot of value for all stakeholders. Imagine a movie a blockbuster which used to go to 500 screens in the pre-2005 era. Because of our digitization, they started going to 5,000 screens from 500. And now imagine if it can go to 20,000 screens each movie. That is when the collection, you know, from 20 crore it moved to 100 crore club, and 100 crore should move to 500 or 1,000 crore club. So I think providing that infrastructure is extremely important. We are also very, very conscious. So we have been, you know, experimenting with that model over the years. We talk about it every time with very limited capex. So now, again, what we have done is so as to not divert the funding of UFO, we have again housed that business also in a wholly owned subsidiary. So Zinglin, Plexigo and the Nova Cinema. And a very interesting model has been worked out, which is the cinema cum utility center with the banking, medical, etc., which is the need of the hour in the country, and also fits in the policy of the vision of the government and the Prime Minister. So all those things are being worked out. Very consciously, we have housed them all in separate subsidiaries so that they are all owned by UFO, separate subsidiaries, very limited capex is being done in them just to keep, you know, experimenting, and once the experiment is successful, raise individual capital. And obviously, the rub of fact that valuation will come into UFO eventually. But idea is not to divert UFO's cash. UFO will continue concentrating on its core business and growing advertisement, core business, digitization, how to create more models, how to expand that business, will continue expanding. Caravan business will continue experimenting on that, concentrating on these in UFO, and other initiatives will be housed in subsidiaries with independent funding. I think, sure. I hope I have given a very comprehensive answer to your question.
Yes, sir, that was very helpful. Sir, just a follow-up, you know, now that your core business also will see a ramp-up, and you will have other businesses also where you would want to scale up. So if from a next 24 months point of view, or next 2 years point of view, you see, and if we had to, you know, I would request you to, divide your, bandwidth amongst them. So what would the share change over the next 2 years?
These are completely different management teams even today. So what UFO people do, they do. They did during the lockdown when the UFO business was shut. We had a huge infrastructure of 1200 plus people. We use those people in maintenance. We use them people for creating new, these products, because nobody had any business and they were being paid. So we just use them for that transition. Now everybody who is required in UFO is back into UFO. And because that is our core business, that is our core strength. And all these projects have been handed over to absolutely individual teams. For example, the Nova Cinema. Nova Cinema has now an independent CEO. This gentleman used to be the CEO of SL World. He is now the CEO of this business. He's created his own totally independent team, which is for the exhibition business. There is no concentration or direction of attention from UFO into that business. Similarly, Zinglin, Plexigo, they all have their own fully staffed. Whichever people were available in UFO, additional people have been assigned there. Rest, they are appointing their own people, raising their own capital. So UFO business is our core business. That is our strength. That is our backbone. Our highest concentration is on these businesses, and this will not be allowed to be affected under any circumstances. So all those businesses are creating their own strength.
Sure. Your thoughts would request for. We've seen that the sharing done by the multiplexes that's changing and is expected to remain so till the end of this financial year with a higher share to the distributors and producers. What does that mean to UFO? On the face of it, you should be actually a beneficiary. Would that be a right understanding?
No. So the content, the sharing of the content revenue is directly between the exhibitors and the producers. Now, since everybody saw very bad times, everybody was struggling to come back. So there was some kind of a transition which had to happen in the industry and some kind of a temporary understanding which had to be developed. So the understanding was in three parts. One was the revenue sharing. Now revenue sharing, producers were demanding 60% revenue, much higher revenue, against a 50 or 52.5% revenue, which for the first week, for example, that was applicable. So that was one issue. The second issue was the OTT window. Because OTT window, the practice was 8 weeks, and producers started selling the movie to make more, to recover their losses, interest costs, etc. during the pandemic to 2 weeks, 4 weeks. So some settlement, when some good sense had to prevail, and when the cinema industry started opening. So whatever experiments kept happening, movie going to the OTT platform, 2 week window, 4 week window, day and date window, all that happened during the pandemic. Now when people saw, when the producers and the exhibitors and everybody saw that the cinema is coming back and movies are meant for the theaters, and the kind of response they saw, they had to sit down and they had to settle it. So they reached a settlement finally. They don't ask insane terms from either side. Yes, let us handle this transition. So one, they agreed that till 31st March 2022, they will give generally a 2.5% extra revenue. Instead of 52.5%, first week will be 55%, but and in second week, instead of 45%, will be 47.5%, like this. So they agreed mutually, informally on those terms. That's what we understand, because we are not part of that chain, but what we learn from the industry. Second, they agreed that till 31st March, and from 1st April 22, the original terms will apply when the industry is back into black. Similarly, for the OTT window, they agreed for 4 week window till 31st March 22, and then from 1st April, the 8 week window will apply. So it's a transition kind of happening. And the third point was the VPF revenue. So everybody was crying, why should we give the VPF and all? And then when we all sat down, all the stakeholders sat down, and we explained to them, and they were very happy. So there is no question, you know, like common parlance that, and we have explained to them very clearly that there is no sunset of VPF. Like you analysts, when you go to talk to a producer, they say, we will not give VPF to UFO. I mean, they have been saying it for last 8 years. So I think everybody should understand that VPF sunset has not happened, and it will not happen, because we are not part of the film fraternity. We are not sharing the prosperity downside or upside of the content. We are a third party independent service providers. We are like a vendor hourly ceiling, but without no other route available. You want to go to the other side, pay my toll and do it. So we have explained to them. Everybody understands that there will be no this thing. So no sunset. So that message has gone very loud and clear during this period. Instead of, you know, sitting every day and fighting about it, which they have been doing for last many years. So now they understand that there will be no sunset, number one. And secondly, we also help them in transition, starting with a 100% discount, as I have earlier explained. And region by region, we are correcting those discounts. And everybody understands that, you know, even in Tamil Nadu and Andhra, when South 3 years back, 4 years back, when they had said, we will not pay the VPF, we will pay the zero VPF. The whole Tamil Nadu industry went on strike. The strike continued for 49 days. Ultimately, they had to pay us the VPF. So I think that is very well settled now overall on the VPF. I mean, I'm going an extra mile to explain to your point. I mean, you asked me some other point, but as I said, there were three points, three issues. One was the revenue share between the producer and the exhibitor. Second was the OTT window. So all those issues have been settled. Third was the VPF. That also issue also has been settled. We have had enough discussion. Who is going to release free of cost even in the month of November? Even a Suryavanshi did not release free of cost. We gave a 50% discount. From next month, discount will further keep going down or to zero in next 1 or 2 months. Maybe next month, maybe another month, depending on how the reopening happens. So all these issues during the pandemic have been settled so that the business, the industry can come back to a steady state affair.
Sure. So the percentage share for the distribution part, that has not increased. It's more or less similar to what it was earlier, to sum up.
I didn't understand that. Percentage share for distribution?
So for your distribution business, the percentage of the box office collection, which was earlier, that's what remains as of now as well, with the producers getting a higher sharing from multiplexes. That has not resulted in a higher increase for you, right? To sum up.
I still did not understand. What is it to... So one is, what is the distributor share? Are you talking about the distribution commission or what?
Yes, sir. I meant the commission percentage.
Commission percentage, these are all very standard businesses which are running for donkey's years, Urmil.
Yeah.
And these percentages are fairly standard.
Which vary
depending on the scope of work. Because what we are also able to do in the distribution business, where we also bring advantage, apart from networking with the exhibitor, apart from ensuring that the collections do happen because exhibitors have to pay to us week on week, we also throw in, you know, our advertising inventory so that we can promote these movies, which is now becoming a norm slowly. Because we can promote the movie, so we can charge a percentage or two extra. So that way our advertising inventory also gets pushed with the distribution business, which people have started seeing the advantage. So depending on the scope, what they are asking us to do, we have also now, what we have done, Urmil, very interestingly, since we don't want to take risk on content, the risk is of two types in the distribution business. One is the risk of the content risk, that, you know, I give MG for content or acquire content or invest in the content or, you know, start making movies, become the producer of the movie. That is a risk on the content. So that is one risk in distribution business. The second risk is the P&A risk, which is the advertising cost, which is substantial, which could be 5, 7, 8 crore rupees per Hindi movie, per big movie. Now, obviously, that is also a risk, because if the collection doesn't come, and often there is a requirement in the market where people ask us that as a distributor, because that also has been a practice in the past, that the corporate distributor used to spend big money on the promotion of the movie, which is the P&A cost. So there was always a need that, you know, if you want to grow in the distribution business, you also have to start money on the P&A. They have print and advertising, and obviously that is not our cup of tea. We don't want to take risk. So now what we have done is, interestingly, we have tied up with a couple of companies who are becoming our P&A partners. So while we distribute movies, either we co-distribute along with them, and these are different sizes. So if I have to put a I don't have the authority to name the people right now, but if I have to put a P&A of say 50 lakh rupees, then I go to the smaller partner, they put 50 lakh rupees, they take a percentage of my distribution commission, and we recover this money on a LIFO basis out of the collection, first pay their money before any money goes to anybody else, and pay X percentage of my commission to them. And where the P&A could be 5 crore, 8 crore, 10 crore, then we have tied up with the bigger partners who are willing to invest because of our strength along with us. And sometimes they are becoming co-distributors, sometimes they are just putting money on the P&A because they know that when the distribution happens, money will be recovered. Their money is not going anywhere, and UFO will be able to settle their dues. So in just very short time, we have not only gone into distribution business, now we have these tie-ups. With the help of these tie-ups, now we have started pitching bigger movies. And that is where I was saying that eventually I believe that from next year, I think the contribution of distribution business will start increasing. And actually, if I become an All India distributor and start releasing, say, 2 movies a week, we are already doing 1 movie a week, whether it's small, whether big. If we start doing 2 movies a week, 100 movies in a year, it's a huge business, can be potentially huge business, can give you substantial bottom line and without any additional expense and risk. So that is what we are doing.
Sure. So, last question, if I may.
Sorry to interrupt, Mr. Shah.
Yeah.
So, may we request that you return to the question queue? There are participants waiting for their turn.
Sure. Okay. Thank you. All the best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ankit from Bamboo Capital. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity. And, sir, you know, I'm new to the company. Two, three basic questions. So, on the VPF side, how much VPF used to contribute to our revenues, pre-COVID, and, how do you see this, VPF coming back to, let's say, 100% over the next near to medium term?
So, as I have already explained, I think the second part, that when do I expect it to come back to 100%, I think it's a matter of 1 or 2 months. If a third wave doesn't happen, another lockdown doesn't happen, the movies which are lined up, and also please understand, so I think there's a question I've already answered that, maybe next month, maybe month after next, depending on when the all capacities get restored, in next 1 or 2 months, VPF should ideally come back to a normalized VPF, which is 100% VPF, unless there is some external factor in the country or elsewhere which happens, which stops release of the movies, which prohibits release of the movies or whatever. So that question is very, very clear. There is absolutely no doubt. And actually the VPF revenue may be higher than the normalized revenue, because we charge VPF generally, the pay-per-show we charge in UFO, that we charge only for first 2 weeks of the movie. And when the movie goes to third and fourth week, we run it free. We don't charge any VPF for third and fourth week on a per show basis. But now there is such a huge slate of movies for the next 6 months that every week there is a new movie coming, which will be pushing out the, which will not allow, except for some big blockbuster, it will not allow the previous week movie to overflow to the third week. For example, after Suryavanshi, now on 19, there is Banti and Bubbly coming. On 26, there is September Jayate 2 coming, which is John Abraham, and there is Antim, which is Salman Khan, which is coming. Now, these movies, Antim and September Jayate, will not allow Banti or Bubbly to overflow to the second or third week too much. So, when the more first and second week movies release, the more money we make, because we charge only for first 2 weeks in the Hindi market, for example. So, I won't be surprised that the VPF revenue gets restored, and we may get on a monthly basis higher VPF revenue once it is restored than normally we would have done in previous years. Because itni movies gather over here, right now so many movies have gathered, they are all falling over each other to release. So, and that takes away all this fear that people were had written the obituary of the film cinema business in during the lockdown. I participated in so many debates that, whether the cinema will survive, OTTs will kill cinema. So that obituary of the cinema, which has been written many times from the advent of TV and videotapes and CDs and OTTs, and the business is coming back faster than expected. And Ashish, can you answer the question of the percentage revenue?
Yeah. So,
I think tell him about the 2019 or 20.
Correct. So, if I tell you the 19-20 numbers, and these numbers are available on the website in the form of our earnings presentation, where we have the consolidated revenue mix. But for your quick reference, I'll tell you that in FY20, we had 31% of our consolidated revenue coming from distribution revenue distributors. And that percentage was 29% in FY19. The breakup in detail, you will find, for example, if you go to the earnings presentation of FY20 on slide 6, this presentation, these details are there. And similarly, you can keep referring to every quarterly or previous periods presentation. This is a specific slide which gives a not just broad 31%, but components of that also in detail.
Sure. And, what will be the impact of, we are even seeing that the movie ticket rates for multiplexes and even in, other cinemas has been, other cinema halls has been increased quite a bit. So, does it impact our revenue shares as well, or does VPF depend on this increased movie ticket rates, or it doesn't?
No, there are three different models of VPF which are prevalent in the market. and none of them is dependent on the collection right now. On the collections, generally, unless we launch another model on the collections or the ticket prices, one model is you pay a one-time BPF and that's it. Run the movie for the life on that particular location. So one is that is the risk of the producer. If he pays which is much higher, a fixed amount, if he pays that and the movie doesn't work, he ends up paying us higher. For us, it averages out. The second model is that you pay on a weekly basis. That you pay for the first week, which is mostly in South. You pay for the first week, you pay for the second week, you pay for the third week, which keeps sliding. So pay one time or pay weekly. Obviously, cumulative amount which he pays if he takes weekly is far higher than the fixed amount. And the third model is on a pay-per-show basis. Every time a show of a movie runs, you pay a fixed amount. For example, if you in Hindi market, it's say 425 rupees for the first week. So for every show, you pay 425 rupees. For the second week, it is 360 rupees. Every show you run, you pay 360 rupees. Third week onward, there is nothing. So there are three models which are prevalent normally, and none of them is dependent on the box office collection or the ticket prices. But higher the ticket prices in our distribution business, it will probably help us, because that is a percentage of the box office collection, the distribution commission that we get, not on BPR.
Sure. So, you know, if you look at, you know, FY19 numbers and we look at the breakup, so, you know, you had 230-240 crore revenues from advertisement. You had VPF contributing, let's say, 160-170 crore. Then you had re-rental income and, sale of products contributing substantially to your sale. So, you know, let's say when everything normalizes, hopefully, and, there is no third wave, does any of our segment get impacted if there is, because of the pandemic in the long term, or all these segments will come back, will normalize, or even, see some improvement over the next year or two?
So I'll tell you, two revenue streams are fairly steady, which is the VPF and the rental. So VPF and rental are pretty much fixed. You will not see much change year on year. Of course, if you compare the VPF of 2019 with 2020 or 18 with 19, you will see a change, because there was a sunset clause in the Hollywood studio agreements. So between 16 and 19 and 20, waterfall impact happened of our sunset agreements, which I'm sure you must be aware of. And if not, then our IR team will be separately happy to engage with you and explain that issue to you. But sure, now, sure. Once the VPF is there, overall VPF is pretty much, it is fixed. That it gives you, say for example, 10 or 11 crore revenue every month, it will continue giving that revenue. When the combination of the films change, for example, that revenue may be slightly higher. Once we go back to 100% and there is a lineup of blockbusters every week or big movies every week, which are pushing out the older movies, then third week onwards we don't charge VPF. So we may end up making slightly higher. That is number one. Number two, so far as the rental business is concerned, rentals are fixed, pretty much fixed for years. So so many theaters, so many equipment, you will see slight variation depending on what kind of projector he has, if somebody is changing the projectors. But I think on the macro level, that will be a kind of a fixed amount. So VPF and rental behave like this. Advertising, obviously, there is variation. So if you see, there was 238 crore, I think, if I correctly remember, in 19, which dropped to under 160 crore in 2020 because government didn't spend money. Caravan business didn't happen. So that varies. And the fourth stream is the equipment sale. Equipment sale is not our business model in India. So we don't sell equipment, we sell only consumables, which is lamp, which is also part of this. And those lamp sale is pretty much steady business. That so many projectors, one lamp goes for so many hours, they keep buying the lamp, which is pretty steady. Again, like VPF and rental, it is fixed business. And we may have certain margin on those rental. But equipment sale is mostly happening in the Middle East. That is when any new market opened. For example, in the last 2 years, Saudi Arabia market opened during the pandemic. So we did a lot of equipment sale in Saudi Arabia. Once that market saturated, there will be no equipment sale. So this will keep going down, and it again happens on a certain fixed margin. So that is how it is.
Okay. And sir, last question on
the start. Mr. Ankit, may we request that you return to the question queue? There are participants waiting for their turn.
Thank you.
We'll move on to the next question. That is on the line of Urmil Shah from Haitong Securities. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir, for the opportunity again. I had just one question pending. Subparts to it. So, Ashley, what would be the promoter shareholding after the fundraise?
23. So,
hi, Urmil. So, the proposed fundraise, the promoter's stake would be 23%.
Sure. And, again, this is linked to the fundraise and also slightly strategic in nature. We have a lot of businesses which we have incubated. What would be the thought of, maybe focusing on few and scaling them up rather than having, multiple moving parts? So just your thoughts on that.
So that is exactly what it is happening. So as I said, the entire management team is divided. Like for example, me personally, Orville, I do not work on any of these new projects. I do not work on any of the new initiatives, which is Nova Cinema or Zinglin or Plexico. I do not spend even 5%, 2% of my time on that. These are all driven by Mr. Sanjay Gaikwad. Mr. Sanjay Gaikwad has limited role in the day-to-day operations of the company. So whatever expansion is happening within UFO Movies, extension of the existing business that I run, for example. So if the distribution business we started, it is extension of the existing business, I am managing it. The whole management team is here. Now there are three basic initiatives, which is Plexico, Zinglin and EUC. These are very different kind. Highest concentration is on the Nova Cinema business. Because that, we have spent years in perfecting that model. We believe we have reached some point now and, that business may actually uptake. But it is not that, you are spending all your time or you are diverting the attention from running the UFO business. So there are three initiatives which are in place in three different subsidiaries. They will find their own path eventually without any major investment from UFO. UFO is only making a startup investment, which is few crore here and there. That's it. I mean, nothing else. I think in all these projects together, we have not invested even 10 crores in last 2 years. So that's what I'm saying. Why to maintain the company, we have spent 300 crore in last during the pandemic period. So that these are only being all these projects are being initiated. So don't worry, there is no attention of the current management going into these projects. Every company has to have the existing business. You have to invest some time and some money in future. These are those future. And they are being handled very, very carefully that there is no diversion of attention from the existing business to invest in future. And it's very, very well balanced within the company.
Sure, sir. Thank you. But just as a humble suggestion that at whatever time you find it appropriate, for a minority shareholder point of view, it would be good that we have less number of businesses and both management and capital bandwidth goes into scaling them up. Just a suggestion.
Well, I take your point, Urmil, but I have already explained to you that both these things are taken care of. If I am telling you that I have spent 300 crores in last 19 months since the pandemic, and out of which all these new businesses, less than 10 crore has gone. So I think by scale itself, I've explained to you that there is no diversion of money or capital efficiency which is being compromised for the core business. Similarly, I've explained to you about time also, but I take your point more. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. The next question is on the line of Manan Patel from Eravat Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, Manan. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for the opportunity, sir. First question is on the distribution. So I understand that PPF is largely paid by producers and sometimes by distributors as well. So when we distribute, when we go into distribution, will it affect PPF in any way, like as in combined sales or something? You might have to reduce VPF or something. Just wanted one.
No, it does not. VPF comes from the revenue collection. VPF is a fixed charge, as I explained under these three different models, which I had explained to you a short while ago. So VPF gets charged that way. The only reason you can lose VPF as a distributor is that suppose the VPF is 50 lakh for a movie and the movie flops so badly that it does not do even a 50 lakh collection. Then you may lose 2-4 lakh upar niche, but normally, I mean, it will be our management failure if we pick up movies which it does not even recover the VPF. So typically a VPF should be 2-3 or minimum, say 10% of the collection, hypothetically. If it is 10% of the collection, and that means you are expecting a 100 collection out of which 10 is VPF, you will lose VPF only if you actually collect only 5. That means you have picked up such a wrong movie, or you have distributed so badly that you are against your anticipation of 100, you are collecting 5 revenue. That is somewhere your own management failure. So that doesn't happen. So VPF is always recovered. So we always have a right of. So out of the collections, first the P&A is recovered if a third party is investing the P&A. VPF is recovered, our trailer revenue is recovered, and then only the overflow goes back to the producer. This is how it happens.
Understood, sir. That's very helpful. And the second question is again on the dilution front. Sir, I understand this is a very big dilution, almost 30% dilution. And the new investor's stake will be higher than the promoter's. So, unfortunately, due to a lot of reasons, we have not been able to create shareholder wealth. And on top of that, we are diluting at a point which is sort of low point of the industry and the stock price as well. So, couldn't it have come at a better time, because we are seeing a lot of upside in terms of business over next few months, and we could have done it at a much better time when we have specific strategic initiatives in place, so that it would have affected all the shareholders, including promoters, a lot less. So what are your thoughts on this?
I completely agree with you. What you are saying is absolutely in place. The issue in front of us was when we started the process of fundraising 4 months back. There was a huge sword of third wave hanging on our head and a extended prolonged lockdown. We were very comfortable last year when the lockdown happened. We said, oh, we have enough cash in our bank account. We have absolutely no problem. Everybody expected that the pandemic will last 3-4 months, July, August 2020, the cinemas will open. They didn't open. They finally opened in October. October to January, there were no major releases. When in March major releases started, April again the lockdown happened. That was a rude shock to us. We had not provided for it. Nobody had thought about it. Nobody in the world. Listen, Madan, after 100 years such a thing has happened. So in the living memory of the existing generation, there was no history or there was no experience available. So when the second lockdown happened, still we expected that second lockdown will happen 1-2 months. When it kept prolonging and it was worse than the first lockdown, and the pandemic was the worse than the lockdown, then we decided that what if this lockdown continues till March next year? Can we survive? Answer was no, because we did not have so much of cash. We survived 19 months. That is when we said instead of losing the company, it is better that you raise some capital, even at the cost of higher dilution. When those commitments were made, the lockdown was lifted. So we said, okay, let us use this cash now, at least for strategic initiatives, for further growth of the company, which we will decide in future. And the promoter's point of view was that instead of holding a bigger chunk in a different company, have a smaller chunk in a much larger company and do the value creation for everybody. So this is the whole idea that, you know, hopefully with new strategic initiatives, with our whatever we are doing, we do a shareholder value creation somewhere, you know, despite you know, from 2015 when we did the IPO till 2020 before the lockdown happened, our combined cash earning pre-tax was 800 crores, 600 crores post-tax earning. We have given 255 crores, 755% dividend in those 5 years. Despite such strong fundamentals, the stock price has not supported us. I wonder why. Why 625 rupees IPO has come down to 90 rupees, 80 rupees, or it came down to 150 rupees pre-lockdown. So we have been putting our effort, we have been earning cash. Just because some rumors are there in the market, the community beats down the stock that, you know, producer says that I will not give the VPF, so this company will shut down. How can the company shut down? So that was the whole thought process. We started anticipating a third wave, and for the we needed capital for the growth. We did not want to be in a situation that suddenly, you know, third wave happens and we have no cash and the company folds up. And even if the pandemic doesn't happen or the third lockdown doesn't happen, we have no money for expansion, because that is how the shareholder value will be created. So this is a sacrifice that the promoter has done in the interest of the larger shareholders.
Understood. So that's very helpful. And I read in the announced notice for EGM, there's not going to be any management change, but are they going to infuse any board members in the company?
They will have a board position on the company.
Understood. Thanks a lot, sir. All the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Vikram Ramalingam for his closing comments.
Thank you, Lizan, and thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for attending the call. On behalf of Maybank Kim Eng, we thank the management of UFO Movies for this call. Good day to everyone.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of UFO Movies India Limited, that concludes this conference call. We thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines. Thank you.